So the Cayman Islands are an ideal location for vacation goers and the development of our industry. With new events such as Kaboo Festival, we'll be sure to see more visitors choose our islands as their next destination. To take a closer look at the current state of the tourism industry is Teresa Leacock-Broderick, President of the Cayman Islands Tourism Association. Teresa was also recently appointed as the new director for the Ritz, the residence at the Ritz-Carlton Grand Cayman. With over 25 years of experience in hospitality and tourism management, she's a knowledgeable, influential voice for our tourism sector. Please welcome Teresa.
Thank you for the Chamber of Commerce for having us here. Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I know it's been a long afternoon for you all, and I've been instructed to kind of move this along. Special welcome to the Honorable Minister still here. I think he stepped out, but ladies and gentlemen, colleagues, friends, I hope there's one or two of you out there, because following Jude Scott, that's a tough act to follow. And unlike him, this is actually my first address to any audience beyond my own membership of the Cayman Islands Tourism Association in my short tenure as its president. And it's a volunteer position, so I feel your pain, Jude, but I have more pains than you. I have taken some notes and learned a few things from you, and the first thing would be that we definitely need to shorten the mission statement. I would love to get ours to like two lines that you had. But suffice to say, Cayman Islands Tourism Association represents about 250 members of tourism-related businesses here in the Cayman Islands. We work to promote the continuing improvement and the development of Cayman Islands tourism industry. Promoting through the promotion of exchange of information, government relations, training and education, and marketing events. So long, I actually made a slide for it. But let's get going. This afternoon, I'm going to give you an overview of the current state of the industry using a few key indicators, nothing as highly numerical as Mr. Scott, and very much from the perspective of the private sector, and again, from our members. I will continue to touch upon the critical challenges with a more of a focus on the local operations. And I will leave the marketing and brand strategy and the trends in the luxury tourism travel sector to the panel discussion question. And finally, I will close kind of sharing what I consider the core essence of Cayman sustainable tourism. A lot of this will be qualitative because as much as tourism is all about relationships and experiences, and from my background in, it's not just 25 years in tourism, but my background working for many years at the National Trust in environmental conservation and heritage preservation and in tourism, I can't help but take the opportunity to cement certain concepts and what is going to be really important to our industry. In general. So last year, last year the Cayman Islands broke the 400,000 threshold in sale of visitors, which represented an increase of 8.55% over 2026 after the previous two flat years. This current year, we continue to break records in both stayover and cruise tour visitation. Early this month, at the CETA AGM, the Honorable Minister for Tourism, Mr. Moses Garcano, shared the most recent year-to-date visitor statistics with us. For the 4 months of January through April 2018, air arrivals were up by 15.36% over the same period last year. Cruise arrivals were up 18% over the same period. The stayover visitor spend during these 4 months alone is estimated to be $216.5 million, that's CI, up $29 million over the same period last year. The cruise visitor spend over these 4 months is estimated at CI $82 million, up $12.7 million over the same period. Now these statistics indicated that the Cayman Islands tourism is growing at a significant pace, considering that the regional average growth in stayover tourism for 2016 was 4.1%, while the average annual average was 3.1% for the preceding 10 years. Some percentage of this year's visitation is due to the loss of business in the Eastern Caribbean's hurricane-impacted islands. However, from dialogue amongst our industry stakeholders, we have embraced this as an opportunity to instill in all our visitors a desire and intention to return to the islands. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to take this opportunity today to dispel any belief that may be out there that our tourism successes to date are a matter of pure luck. Yes, much has to do with the global economy, particularly that of the U.S., and we have to remain thankful each and every hurricane season that we have spared devastation. However, we need to acknowledge the strategic execution that the Ministry and the Department of Tourism deploys, along with the active participation and robust investment by the private sector, including the financial secretary. We actually really like that relationship. It's a good marriage. The major drivers for the industry include increasing air service. The airline continues to expand with more direct flights, frequency, and routes being developed. And we're experiencing increasing accommodations capacity. New development projects currently slated will provide a 20% increase in tourism accommodations over the next 2 to 3 years. This is new developments alone, roughly half a dozen, and it does not include existing condominiums and homes that are steadily coming forward as licensed tourism accommodations as demand for vacation home rentals also expands. Sorry, I realize I didn't move my slides. Okay. On the infrastructure side, in addition to the massive road works that, as we have learned, should be finished this fall, the expansion of the Orrin Roberts International Airport is on target for completion this year, and as we know, the planned development of the cruise ship berthing facility is in the last stages of its tendering process. As far as the trickle-down effect, on the front line of the tourism-related businesses, we are steadily seeing businesses and entrepreneurs entering the market, which is an important segment for the economy. The industry growth in auxiliary services is particularly evident in water sports, private boat charters, marine-based activities, and marine craft rentals. There are smaller niche restaurants and food-related experiences coming online, as well as health and wellness offerings. Destination management services are also on the rise, and individual taxi operators are crossing over into offering more special interest tour-oriented services. I see one right in the room today. In all, we can reasonably expect that the tourism industry in Cayman will continue to grow, hopefully without any temporary disruption from nature or global events beyond our control. However, we do face challenges that we believe are time-sensitive that the Cayman Islands will continue to successfully offer world-class experiences and appeal to discerning travelers. The most critical challenge at this point in the short and medium term relates to managing the services and the visitor experience, the growth and the market maturity demands. The National Tourism Plan, it's in its final stages now, as I understand, and should be released in the next couple of months. Now, this 5-year plan comprehensively addresses all of the industry's challenges and opportunities, but it extended extra focus on visitor management services, and that's really the crux of our challenges locally at this point in time. Now, if you're not familiar with this plan, I seriously consider encouraging you all to get familiar with it, because it will impact, I think, just about everyone who is suddenly touched by tourism. As comprehensive as this national policy plan is, the real challenge will be its execution, as many critical pathways lie outside the auspices of the Ministry and Department of Tourism. The National Tourism Plan must be integrated with other national policies and legislation, otherwise it will be meaningless. It will be incumbent for all stakeholders to participate and politically hold the entire government accountable to stay on point. Now, regardless of where and how quickly the National Tourism Plan will take us, there are some time-critical concerns held by many tourism stakeholders and residents in general. These mostly revolve around safety and enforcement, which involves government. With the increase in the number of visitors and residents alike, the risk of serious negative incidents and accidents also increase. Therefore, preventative and response measures must also increase. Prevention calls for higher regulatory standards in some areas and more efficient, effective enforcement. Heard regulation enforcement earlier this afternoon, so it seems to be a common thread among all the industries. But these are necessary measures to ensure safety, to maintain the quality of service or experience, and to protect and preserve our natural resources. This applies most critically right now to all marine-based activities and marine craft. The use and maintenance of public lands and beaches, most urgently being the 7 Mile Public Beach and the preservation of Cayman Seas and marine life. Crime prevention, road and marine safety, and emergency medical services all remain critical to Cayman's reputation. Incidences indicate that our emergency medical services may not be adequate for key locales and peak hours. We need to honestly assess our strengths and weaknesses in this area and take action for change accordingly, and not discount the potential of joint public-private sector provided services, particularly as medical tourism continues to develop. Public transportation and taxi services. This is a key auxiliary service, and the regulation and service management of this sector remains substandard to our industry service level expectations. This is another area that requires honest reassessment and consideration of the best management model to employ. And again, we should not discount possible contracted private service involvement, and certainly not discount entrepreneurs. Workforce development and employment. We must continue to make strides in attracting and developing more Caymanians to careers in tourism. But realistically, especially with the figure that Stuart gave us, 2,000, realistically, the workforce required for the current and growing levels of the industry will still necessitate expatriates in the foreseeable future. Therefore, the work permit process remains a critical component to the industry. However, if human resource development and immigration can only successfully align, there may be scope for key areas to be reserved for Caymanians in the future. Legislation and the business environment. As we revise or create new legislation, we must do so with a framework and regulations that allow the public sector to timely respond to the rapid and constant changes in the marketplace. At this point, the industry is looking forward to long overdue revisions to the tourism law, the hotel licensing law, the liquor licensing, music and dance control laws, all of which could have a positive impact on our business environment. Meanwhile, we are considering what could be potentially costly impact to the industry, particularly for smaller businesses, if the proposed consumer protection law is enacted in its current form. Finally, the balance between stayover and cruise tourism. This continues to be debated. While there are varying degrees and various reasons for support and or concern over the Cruise Brother facility amongst the private sector, CETA members included, there seems to be a general trepidation as to what getting it right entails and whether the country can manage a far greater number of cruise visitors when government still struggles with management and enforcement issues at the current levels of visitation. In all, appropriate solutions to these current critical challenges translates to opportunities, and opportunities that will improve the industry and create sustainable growth. Now, as I mentioned before, my background in conservation and historic preservation, tourism, and quite honestly, being a mother. As I see it, there are four pillars of Cayman's tourism successes that are timeless, in particular as we strive to position Cayman as a lifestyle brand. We have our service environment, built environment, natural environment, and our social environment. Now, the service environment relates to all auxiliary services, such as culinary, transportation, water sports, anything beyond the brick and mortar, hotels, or infrastructure such as airports and roads, which comprises the built environment. The natural environment, of course, is our natural resources such as clean beaches, pristine waters, healthy coral reefs, marine life, and terrestrial habitat. The social environment is actually all that relates to who we are culturally and our values, is how we treat others, our friendliness, our respect for others, and private property, privacy, and safety is the very fabric of our society. Now, we can always improve and elevate services, and we can renovate and rebuild buildings and infrastructure. We have proven that we can expand airports and roads, even during the height of busy seasons. But once our natural and social environments are compromised and deteriorated, it's very difficult, if not impossible, to regain the original caliber. So in all that we do to grow tourism, we must ensure that we protect our natural resources and our social fiber. I want to share with you this afternoon, I know time is tight. I moved to the States with my family when I was very young. My mother worked for Canaries in the Department of Tourism. So I learned at a very early age how to be an ambassador for Cayman, a tourism ambassador for Cayman. And quite honestly, I feel like I've been doing it all my life. And quite honestly, we all need to be, whether here at home or overseas. But most recently, I had the opportunity to attend a conference of the Maori International Luxury Brands. And I'm always proud to when people are excited to tell me about how they love Cayman, either they've been here as a visitor or they used to live here as a resident. This one lady, Susan, was very enthusiastic and she wanted to share with me how she even discovered Cayman. As it turned out, she's a mother of three girls. Her and her husband were soccer moms and dads, and they had accompanied their girls to Honor 15 invitational tournament at Walt Disney World. This was about 10 or 12 years ago. Turns out our Cayman girls team was there. Now, the New York team, she was upstate New York, one of our main source markets, they shamefully defeated our team. But what ended up happening, as all the other teams went on to enjoy the theme park, our Cayman Islands girls were the only team that stayed back and cheered the team that had shamefully defeated them as they went on to the finals. And that struck a chord with that family, the entire team with that family. And of course, the next winter, when they had to choose where they were going to go for their winter vacation, they chose Cayman. That was 10, 12 years ago. She said, quick to tell me how much her and her family, her girls, continue to love Cayman. They come as often as they can, and they make sure to tell everyone that they know that Cayman Islands is the place to come in the Caribbean. And that is a story about how we are culturally intertwined with our tourism. Cayman is a wonderful place to live and to vacation. Ultimately, it's a shared space and shared experiences amongst residents and visitors alike. What's good for tourism is generally also good for residents. We enjoy excellent air service, good roads and civic infrastructure, good medical care, great restaurants and entertainment, glorious weather, and naturally the beauty of our islands. But as we envision what a viable tourism industry looks like 3, 5, 10, 20, 50 years from now, let us not overlook or take for granted the safety and well-being of residents and visitors alike, and a genuinely friendly, caring community. Those involved with choosing Cayman time, and again, it's funny how relationships happen, but I personally know that it was Jude Scott and PR Bush was involved with that, and perhaps a few others, but you did a fine job. Today, many years later, it still encapsulates our genuine care and friendliness and our genuine desire to share our island and culture with others. It is a core competitive advantage. You all travel. It is a competitive advantage. We must nurture it so that it continues to be a way of being well into the future. I thank you for your time and interest today. I hope that what I have shared provokes you to deeper thought and discussion, and to demand better regulations and enforcement services, and certainly greater integration amongst our government authorities, departments, and agencies. And I hope that we're encouraged to recommit, each and every one of us here today, to continue collaborating and contributing within and across our respective industries for the betterment of the Cayman Islands. Thank you.